I'm Mark Staff Brandl, an artist from America and Switzerland, now in the place where I was born, Peoria, Illinois, having one of my panels painting installations, kind of giant walk-in comics, at the Contemporary Art Center in Peoria. But it's actually not just my show. This is me, but I'm doing it with Gary Scoles and Thomas Emil Homerin, who I'll talk about more later, and they will talk about their own works, or parts of this work, as we come to aspects of it. We collaborated on a giant walk-in comic book installation. Through the installation, the way it goes from left to right, seeing the story develop and talking about specific aspects. As you see here, the three of us drawing in the Contemporary Arts Center. It says our story begins here on Saturdays, because as children, that is when we drew together and made our comics. And here is a drawing by Gary showing the three of us creating a hero, the ally. It was actually created by Emil when we were children, but we're using him as our main fantasy character. He will have an interaction with the bad guy called the Sleepwalker, which is the fantasy element of the installation. We also have more realistic elements that have to do with our thinking about time. It begins here with thoughts take shape. And our heroes are born. Here we have our three hands, with sort of finger puppets, showing many of the heroes we created as young children. Left, for example, is Captain Bold, there's Micro, Silver Streak, Martha Strip, the Ally, Colonel Radiation, Crime Conqueror, the Challenger, Night Raiders, Espionage Agent 13, Bird Dog, the Gambler, Black Death, Universian, Captain Chip Blue. This is one I painted to think about what to talk about thinking about our past. As the days slowly pass. These are small doodles that primarily I made on the backs of envelopes and so on over a year, which we incorporated into the whole story structure, or let's say Emil incorporated into it. Thoughts and dreams, which he will discuss later.
Yeah, my contribution to this here is probably a little more nostalgia. I'm probably the one that embraces that more than contemporary. Like my two cohorts, like a little more modern. On the other hand, when it comes especially to movies, you can see that this here pretty much says it all as far as what I like in horror films. Bringing back an era that sadly no longer exists today. The Universal Monsters, the classics. And down below is just a big throw-in in anything that came to my mind from the comics. Everything from Captain America to one of our very own creations here, Captain Bold. Just a series of heads here a little bit. Obscure characters the mainstream probably don't know, like Blue Beetle, to of course, unless you've lived under a rock the rest of your life, you would know who this is, the Batman.
You are saying something profound.
Suddenly, there is turbulence in the life stream.
Thank you.
Where are the heroes of yore?
Well, other than just comic books, movies and television had a great influence on our lives, and up above here represents the movie aspect of our lives. When we were kids, Japanese monster movies were all the rage. Godzilla, Mothra, Ghidorah, Rodan. In this picture here, I combined it a little bit with Pekin by the three top Japanese monsters going against the Pekin Dragon. The park pavilion here was always kind of cool with its peaks and temples and all that kind of thing. It kind of reminded me of Mongo City in Flash Gordon. So we mixed it here with Flash Gordon. We put Ning the Merciless here. I put Ning the Merciless above the Asian Queen, which was part of the decor of the Pekin Theater. It was on each side of the screen with this here. The Pekin Theater, excuse me, had a Chinese motif to it. So we had this on each side. Now the rest of this pretty much represents what was big in the 60s and what we loved at the Pekin Theater. Friday night, back in the day, there was the triple feature, which you no longer see in today's movie-going society. We had John Wayne in movies like Son of Katie Elder and Chisholm. Clint Eastwood in his Spaghetti Western trilogy. You had these muscle men movie that they made chiefly over in Italy with Gordon Scott and Steve Reeves. You'd have things called stuff like Hercules versus the vampire women, or Samson versus Ulysses, or something like that. They were all the rage, but they were kind of the predecessor to Arnold Schwarzenegger. Hammer films out of Britain, Christopher Lee, Peter Cushing, they were the all the rage in the horror times then. They were Count Dracula and Dr. Frankenstein, respectively. They were considered the bloody movies of the day. Nowadays they would be considered probably pretty mild. And of course, the 60s, unless you lived under a rock all that time, you would realize that James Bond, Sean Connery, was the top box office guy. And probably one of the most memorable things at the Pekin Theater was 1967. Tom Homerin and my brother and I went to see a double feature, Goldfinger and Dr. No, and I've never been the same since. So that was one of the memories as a child that movies had a lot of influence. Now, on the subject of Bond, we go down to TV. And the knockoffs, the watered-down version of James Bond, was The Man from U.N.C.L.E. I might add also that movies, imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, so to jump on the Bond wagon, we had Derek Flint, played by James Coburn in two films. As I said, went down to The Man from U.N.C.L.E. Roger Moore was a saint before he was a 00. The Avengers, John Steed, Diana Rigg, the heartthrob of one of my cohorts, Mark Brandl. I, on the other hand, prefer Julie Newmar's Catwoman. We discovered women on television, what can I say? Morticia, Carolyn Jones from the Addams Family here with Gomez, probably the most passionate couple on television in the 60s. A little-known character, a TV show that only lasted for one season called THE Cat when we were in the sixth grade. Thomas Hewitt Edward Cat. Now, my other cohort, Tom Homerin, T-H-E, Emil Homerin, he kind of, that was where this came from here a little bit. He was a cool guy. He wore a black turtleneck sweater, and so then grade school, we liked him so much, we also got black turtleneck sweaters as well. Had a big influence on us. Space Ghost, Saturday morning cartoon fair. Oh, by the way, the little M&M guy, homage to my wife. She collects M&Ms, and she came in this world in 1965, so that's her contribution there. Star Trek, of course, was a 60s phenomena. Twilight Zone, The Outer Limits, early 60s sci-fi fare. Local shows, we had the Captain Jinx show. This was a local show, a kids show that we all grew up with. Cartoons, The Three Stooges, and they also aired the 50s TV series The Adventures of Superman with George Reeves. Of course, our Batman of the day was Adam West, which was about a two-year phenomenon in the 60s, from 66 to 68. And of course, I mentioned the luscious Julie Newmar already. The Lone Ranger's up there, reruns of it in the 1960s. The 1950s series rerun the 60s, much the same way Superman is. The Green Hornet and Kato, short-lived TV series just like the THE Cat. Our local horror show was on Saturday nights at 10:30, Nightmare Theater. That's where I discovered the Universal Classics.
Where are they now?
It was a very good year.
This painting is in the technique I used in most of these, which is actually dripped oil paint. Somewhere between my hero Gene Colan of Daredevil fame, Jackson Pollock, and Tintoretto. As you see with me, this is based on the photo of me I often use with my brush on fire. Above us, if it's not clear, is actually the three tails of a word balloon, which I thought would symbolize the whole show as we talk about ourselves. And as Gary has reminded me, this is not actually 40 years, it's a bit more, as we are now 56, but I tend to think we're younger. And still thinking of us as 11 years old as at the top. And that was the idea behind the show, is I wanted to bring back the team as we had these many years. And this was an active part of the exhibition as we created this show live here in the space, the three of us, as we did on Saturdays in our past.
It was a very good year.
I'm Thomas Emil Homer, and I'm the third member of this triumvirate creating chaos in the universe. And this is all part of the meanwhile show, is that one of the things that we wanted to capture is have a good architecture to the show, in the sense that the various pieces come together well to build a structure as well as a narrative. And so we have it in three pieces. You've seen the first two pieces, beginning with our story and the production of comic books on Saturday, and moving over to the element of nostalgia and the beautiful rendition that Gary Scoles did, involving many of our own idols that influenced our pieces, and the linking it together over a period of time. One of the things that you have observed till up until this point is the small drawings that Mark Brandl made, oftentimes doodles. And he collected these over a period of time and handed me a packet of them and said, distribute them. Use this to kind of create a narrative structure. And we did that. Gary Scoles came up with the title Meanwhile. As I said, it's the idea is life happens while you're making plans. And so I decided to take a series of captions, meanwhile, suddenly, tomorrow, as a way of structuring this in a narrative fashion. And so at one point we decided, let's bring in a story, a real comic story, as we would have done it, or conceived of it perhaps, when we were drawing back in the day. And that's what we have behind me here, is that I've taken a series of Mark's doodles and then put captions on them. So let's go to the story. What's wrong? I can't sleep. Everything seems a jumble of dreams at midnight. It's 3 a.m. Who is she? Her perfume. So familiar. ...6 a.m. Or was she my best friend? But I never had a dog. So why do I know she loves Frisbee? ...9 a.m. In a wonderland they lie, dreaming as the days go by, dreaming as the summers die. Noon, while a short distance away. ...3 p.m. Then, before too very long, I'm out of sorts. Why? ...6 p.m. Apples. The autumn was her favorite season. ...9 p.m. Every whisper of every waking hour, I'm choosing my confessions. It was just a dream, just a dream. Midnight. The air is crisp. Why can't I sleep? Now, one of the things, as you've heard the story, that I was trying to do was to use the images, the words, to connect together, and in a sense, that's what the show is all about. This is one of the wonderful elements of comics and graphic novels, is those uses of terms and images to create a complete picture. But you don't need superheroes, necessarily, so much of the show has superheroes, but it's about the sequential nature of art and of life. And so one of the reasons why we have the times in here is that I wanted to have a basic adventure or story, which here is about lost love or remembered love or imagined love or dreamed love. You don't know, but it didn't matter. But you've got the time sequence because one of the oldest metaphors is life is a day. And as well, we had the fragrance in the beginning, the reference to summer, the apples of autumn and the crisp air of winter. We have yet another metaphor running gently underneath about a year as a life and of the various seasons. But then we cut away to this wall and suddenly we're back in the world of comics. And now we've moved from our love story here to a wall with action and the heroic resolution of the issue.
Awake, how long you have slept.
The ally, is this a dream?
The sleepwalker prowls your dreams, leading you to others, tapping your energy and emotion. Time is short.
I sense the ally. Again, he interferes.
Sleepwalker, leave his dreams. Your race is run.
Here is the final scene
of the pursuit, confrontation, and resolution of the battle between the ally and the sleepwalker as they run across the bridge, linking this world and the world of the next, the world of the subconscious with the conscious, and so forth. And in the battle, the ally ultimately bests the sleepwalker, who plunges into the waters of time. Day dawns.
And life goes on. Our fathers, played by screen actors in the docudrama of our lives. Left, Jimmy Cagney, Earl. Middle, John Wayne, Floyd. Right, George Peppard, Carl.
That was great. Well, guys, all good things come to an end, huh?
Yeah.
All depends on what your definition of good things are, but I mean, this is the end, isn't it?
Yeah, and Gary thought that was a little bit stiff, and I guess he's right, but that was serious.
Yeah, but at our age, we're jealous of the stiff wind, so what do you think?
That was the serious part, documentary part. Now we're at the end of it. Meanwhile, the panel's painting installation.
There it is.
That was that.
Yeah, there it is. One of the guys making an ass of himself.
As usual.
What was nice about the whole process, though, is we got together yet again, and we actually created yet another great supervillain in the Sleepwalker, a group effort, and using that in a way to show how we did it.
And it wasn't just number one, and it wasn't just an origin.
No origin issue.
We have it, and we completed it.
I've got to say, of all the characters we created back in the 60s, when we were 10, 11 years old, I think the Sleepwalker character was probably one of the most provocative, interesting ones. You can tell that we aged a little bit because this guy got a little deep, because really most of our characters were kind of, we were so influenced by the Marvel and DC generation that they were basically spin-off knockoffs of other superheroes. But Sleepwalker could actually be considered original. I mean, I liked this character. I thought it was, and I liked how we add things that related to sleep to the costume. I mean, a lot of superheroes, even in the professional world today, you know, they put on spandex and they look good and they call themselves a name and they'll say, well, why this particular color? Why do you have these funny sleeves? Why gloves that come clear up to here? It looks great in comics. It looks great in the three primary colors. But is it functional? Now, this character, Sleepwalker, that Mr. Homerin come up with, had, you know, there was reason why he looked and why he existed and why he functioned.
Another fun thing, too, that we're doing here is to see when we're not 12 anymore and how the actual, as Brandl points up in many of his installation pieces, is that using sequential images and words is not just the privilege of comics, and you can take that and bring it into the larger art world and to tell a story about life that may or may not have superheroes.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I'll be really heretical, but the superhero aspect didn't really interest me. I saw it only as a way to re-relate to us, and so for me the whole adventure that was so great here was to have an adventure, not with Sleepwalker, but have an adventure with Thomas Emil and with Garrett again. And so it was a return. And to not be alone. As I've said repeatedly, I'm always doing this stuff alone. This was wonderful. This was like having a band, being a solo musician, and finally getting to have somebody who plays with you. So you get to...
Yeah, I think I can speak for all three of us that there's things that we come across in the comic book world or the movie world. And being it apart for me. Hey, you dropped something, Mr. Cameraman.
Boy, there goes Mark.
Did you have something you wanted to say?
Yeah.
is this your indiscreet way of saying, hey, I got something to say?
Yeah, he's the unseen man behind the iron who did this.
The thing is, a lot of times, being apart from each other, living on other corners of the universe or whatever, one of us will see a comic book or a movie or a television show, and because we were so close on these themes, we'll often wonder, I wonder what Homerin would think of this. I wonder what Brandl would think about this. You know, and of course they're not there, a phone call away. But I think that's probably why we didn't get started on this until about maybe Tuesday, going like great guns to get it done, because Monday we're having too much fun and talking about anything that really related to what we were actually supposed to be
He's
doing.
He's talking like we're done. William probably, he's still got to finish the book buildings over
our
there.
Our executive at Peoria under the bridge.
Our executive director, William, probably felt, what in the hell
yeah,
what's is this
he's the director of the gallery. Got a voiceover? You want
to come on in, William. Yeah, the man here. Mr. William Bowman.
Got some spontaneous thoughts.
I think it was really cool what you guys have created here. Such a different kind of exhibit that we couldn't better have. So we're really pleased how the public has also joined in and come to see what you guys are doing and all themselves too. So it's really exciting to see.
That was kind of the problem, right? Because at first we were having more fun talking to the people, and Gary drew the Power Ranger for a little boy, and I drew a bridge for somebody. We were having so busy. Fun doing that, we were not getting as far enough on the pictures.
I'll tell you what was fun about that door opening every once in a while, and I made reference to an old TV show, the Dean Martin Variety Show, where part of the format of that show was every week he'd be sitting on the piano talking to the piano player, and as the ritual every week, there would always be somebody come to the door and he'd come out and open it. Supposedly, Dean never knew who it was coming through the door. But that's what it kind of reminded me of. We'd be working away and all of a sudden, look who stopped in, Roger Nelson or Scott Mudgee. We had many guest stars come in. The majority of them we knew, but some of them we didn't know.
Preston Jackson.
But it gave it a network variety. I wish we had the camera going when people came in, because it would have looked at people watching probably all day. It was spontaneous.
And I'd like particularly as one who's usually alone in these things, thank my co-artist, because first Gary's all this fabulous and he brought in all these interests, but also a really emo man to pull our fat out of the fire and getting it to make some sense, bringing in all those levels of sleep and time, which turns it into really a fine art show.
He's had to pull our fat out of the oven enough, and thank you, buddy, the chef hat.
Yeah. And so really, it brings in what's great about what he did, too, is we each had our strengths. He's got the strength that is like a scholar of all our influences, minus the fine art and art history context. He brought in all the subtlety layers, all this symbolism, which I hope you all read into it as you were reading along, but sleep and time and our life and the life of the culture in general and so on, and I don't need to explain all that, although I probably will, because that's the sort of stuff I write.
As Emil Lugosi would say, you have said something very profound.
That's a wrap.